Welcome this morning to our virtual service, our service on Zoom. Okay, I'd love to read to you a short passage from Colossians to help focus our mind this morning and our thoughts. Many of us have had a week that has been quite unexpectedly busy. Plans for the start of term have been disrupted, whether you're a teacher or a parent or a grandparent or whatever. The fact that the school's shutting at the last minute has thrown many people into having to rethink plans, rethink how you do life. And so this week has probably felt pretty hard for some people. And we bring all of that with us this morning. It's not a case that we come as perfect people pretending that we've lived a perfect life this week and that everything has been hunky-dory. We actually come as we are, and we bring all of our struggles and our exhaustion, but also our hopes and our aspirations and our desire for God. We bring all of that this morning as we gather together and draw ourselves into his presence and ask for the Holy Spirit to draw us deeper into his purposes and his presence this morning. So the reason I'd love to read you these verses from Colossians is so that we get a chance to raise our eyes above what is real, what is happening around us, but to glimpse Jesus, supreme and above it all, this morning. That's not to say that what is happening to us isn't real, isn't a struggle, isn't a challenge, but to recognize that Jesus is in it and that he is Lord over it all. So these words from Colossians 1, beginning at verse 15. Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before God made anything at all and is supreme over all creation. Christ is the one through whom God created everything in heaven and on earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see. Kings, kingdoms, rulers, and authorities. Everything has been created through him and for him. He existed before everything else began, and he holds all creation together. Christ is the head of the church, which is his body. He is the first of all who will rise from the dead, so he is first in everything. For God, in all his fullness, was pleased to live in Christ, and by him, God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of his blood on the cross. This includes you, who were once so far away from God. So this morning, I would love for us to be able to focus on Jesus, on his supreme radiance, his glory, recognizing that he is yet Emmanuel. He is with us in this situation that we're in right now, but he also reigns supreme. And we're going to have a couple of songs now. It's going to be a time, I hope, where you feel free to worship, to sing along, turn your camera off if you prefer to give yourself the freedom to wander around, raise your hands, dance, whatever. If that helps you, then by all means, for this time, turn your camera off so you feel utterly free between you and God to worship him and to give yourself to him in praise and worship. And during this time, I would invite you to be attentive to the Spirit, to listen out. Maybe God will prompt you with a verse of scripture that comes to mind, or a picture of something that is an encouragement to someone else. Perhaps you simply will have a prayer, a short prayer or word on your heart that springs up that is for the church, to encourage the church. So today, instead of a shout out question, what I'd encourage you to do during these songs is, if something occurs to you, to write it in the chat. And if you could send that chat to Anna, who should be towards the top of the list on our in our chat box, just to write that short praise or those words of encouragement or that scripture that comes to mind, whatever it might be, to put that in the chat. And then as we continue to worship, even after the singing is finished, we'll continue to worship by listening to those as Anna reads those out for us at the end of this time together. So Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before God created anything. He is above and beyond. He is the first of all things. And so we're going to use these couple of songs now to worship him And the first is a blessing. We normally finish our services with a blessing, but actually we're going to start by listening to a blessing, because why not bless one another and receive the blessing of God right now as we begin our time together. So let me just say a word of prayer, an invitation for the Holy Spirit, and then Gareth will lead us, give us those songs to use for our worship. Remember, you can feel free to turn your cameras off, use the chat function so that we can encourage one another and continue our worship with words as well as with music. So let's pray. Holy Spirit of God, we ask for you to come now, unite us in our worship, even though we are in separate places right now. Yet we are also in one way all together, worshiping God, entering into his presence. And so we ask, Holy Spirit, that you will do your work in us to free us to worship, enable us to approach the throne of Christ, the throne of God, without fear, but with truly grateful hearts because of all that Jesus has done for us. Holy Spirit, remind us, revive us, relight, rekindle that flame of passion and of excitement and of joy at what Jesus has done for us. And as we use these songs, we ask that you would speak to us. Draw near to us as we draw near to you now, and lift our hearts as we praise you and worship you. And we receive all that you have for us this morning. In the name of Jesus Christ, the one who is first and beyond and above all, the one whom we love, we adore. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. 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 The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give peace. Amen. 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 Amen.
their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you.
Turning lives around,
never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working.
Thank you. Is there some messages from the church, from the Holy Spirit to the church that you can share with us?
Yeah.
Thank you.
So, in this time that feels like great darkness, Lord, may we focus on the light that is Jesus. Amen. Thank you, God, that even through all the scary news about the pandemic, we have you as our rock. And no matter what happens, you will be there. Psalm 121. I will lift mine eyes unto the hills. From whence cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord, who hath made heaven and earth. Amen. Wait for the Lord and be strong. Take heart and wait for the Lord. Psalm 27. 14. And from Emma, yesterday I took Arthur for an eye test and he got glasses for the first time. He was quite blurry, bless him, great parenting. When he put the glasses on for the first time, his little face lit up with such joy and wonderment at being able to see better. It was beautiful. My prayer is that we might all get new spiritual glasses and be able to see Jesus afresh, more clearly, and know him more deeply, and have that spark of joy and wonderment in our faces. And from Ephesians 3, we pray that out of his glorious riches, he, our Father, may strengthen us all here together now with power through his Spirit in our inner beings, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. And we pray that we, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, our Saviour, and to know that even now this love surpasses knowledge, and that we will be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Amen. Back to you, Eleanor.
Thank you. And thank you for that beautiful, those beautiful words of prayers and scriptures that you shared. Can we continue in an attitude of prayer as we consider the things going on around us in the world? And whilst we do, let's hold on to that image of Christ, supreme above all, the way maker, the miracle worker, the promise keeper, the light in our darkness. So I'm going to lead us in a few sort of headings, really, and I'm going to leave space for you to pray silently to pray with those on the sofa next to you, or even if you feel you want to unmute yourself and speak a word of prayer that the church can share. But we'll move through a time of praying for others now. So let's continue to pray. And as we're sort of just moving beyond the season of Christmas, we still have those titles of Jesus in ringing in our ears. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. So as we consider Jesus as the Wonderful Counselor, Lord, we ask that you will bring wisdom to those who are battling the pandemic and those who are in positions where decisions have to be made, data needs to be analysed and understood, policies put in place, right up on governmental and world level, but even down the chain, right to local schools and councils and businesses. Wonderful Counselor, we need your wisdom. Everlasting Father, your arms of love, those strong arms that embrace us and hold us and carry us. As we picture those and recognize your Father heart towards all you've made, we ask for you to bring those arms of love to enfold and comfort those who mourn at this time, those who are grieving. We think, obviously, of those who are grieving, loved ones that have been lost because of COVID. But also we lift to you Indonesia with this recent plane crash and the shock of that. We pray for those we know closer to home who are grieving. And sometimes it is the loss of a loved one. Sometimes it's grief at the loss of hope, a loss of independence, a loss of contact and friendship, and the loneliness that comes with that. Everlasting Father, wrap your arms of love and comfort around those we name before you now in the silence. Prince of Peace. We've been shocked to look on at what's been going on in America this week. And Lord, it seems that the divisions and the animosity run so deep. The thirst for violence, for revenge, or for justice as one side views it, over and above what the other side says is just and fair. Lord, the divisions are so deep. Prince of Peace, we need your peace in this world. We ask for people of peace to be raised up in that nation. We pray for peacemakers at every level of government and influence in communities to have a voice and to have influence. Pray for your spirit of peace and reconciliation. And although it's the USA that's hit our headlines this week, we know there are many regions in this world where peace feels like a long way off. where there is still war and conflict, where there is anxiety and real concern over the shortage of food, over the numbers of refugees that have left one place in search of asylum, in search of a safe place. Lord, so much anxiety, so much need for peace. In the silence, we lift to you those nations or situations or individuals that you bring to our minds so that we can give them to you and ask for you, Prince of Peace, to work in their situation and to bring your peace to their hearts and minds. Mighty God, we look to you. Like that psalm says, we might look to the hills, but we know where our help comes from. Our help comes from you, the maker of heaven and earth. Many of these situations that concern us at the moment seem so vast, so impossible to solve, so big that we can't see an end to them. But you are our mighty God, and we look to you, and we ask for you to move, move in power. We pray for an end to this pandemic, an end to the death toll from COVID. We pray for an end to violence on our planet, an end to the greed and selfishness and lust for power and possession that means many, many people go without. We pray for justice. We pray for you to bind up the brokenhearted, protect the vulnerable, and mobilize your people in every nation, in every locality, to be bearers of the truth and the hope of the gospel, but workers for the kingdom, to see your kingdom of righteousness, of justice, of peace, to be grown, to be seeded, to be harvested in the places where your people live. Raise up your people. And we recognize that we are in that number. Raise us up. Energize us, mobilize us, equip us, and commission us, Lord, to be your hands and feet, to bring about your kingdom in this place as it is already in heaven, where you reign. May you reign in this world too. May you reign here in Chudley and in the other places that we represent this morning. May your will be done. All for the glory of Jesus, we pray these things. Amen. Friends, we're beginning a new series of teaching this week, which will take us through to who knows when, as long as it does. But we're going to be looking at the Gospel of Mark together. It's one of the, well, it is the shortest gospel. And if you felt like you were up for a challenge, why not grab a coffee one day and sit down and read it start to finish? I've been reliably informed it shouldn't take much longer than 45 minutes. But I suppose that depends on how fast a reader you are. But it is a short gospel, and so we're going to be trying to look through it together week by week as we approach Lent, certainly, and on into Lent itself. A couple of pointers before we hear a little bit of the opening chapter of Mark, something that would maybe help you just to place it and get a handle on this gospel. Each of the gospels is very different in character, written obviously by different people and written for different people as well. Mark's gospel is probably the earliest written, possibly around 65 AD, possibly as late as 70 AD, but probably not later than 70 AD, because that's one of the crucial moments in dating things, because that's when Jerusalem was ransacked and the temple was destroyed. And that was such a big thing in the life of Israel that is noted in all the writings that sort of happened since. So we think it's probably before that happened. It's based on Peter's eyewitness account, but written by someone called Mark or John Mark, who, if you read carefully, you might catch a glimpse of a couple of times in the story itself that he sets out in this gospel. But Mark was one of the followers of Jesus, but not one of the 12. And his account being the earliest is also then used as the basis for both Matthew and Luke, as they sought to gather the stories of Jesus and the accounts and the different testimonies and writings and produce their own version of the gospel of Jesus Christ. They used Mark as a basis for that and then added in other resources writings and testimonies that they had gathered. Mark is written to a mixed church of Jews and Gentiles, and we know this because, again, if you read carefully, you'll pick up every now and again an explanation, a little explanatory note that wouldn't have been necessary if your readers were all Jewish. So he refers to maybe some of the festivals or the traditions of the Jews and then explains what they are, which tells us that he was expecting that some of his readers at least wouldn't have been familiar with the Jewish culture. And it's widely believed that this is written to the church at a time of great persecution. And that does fit with the timing of when we think it was written, probably during the reign of Nero, who you remember when there was a great fire, he blamed it on the Christians. And then there was a dreadful purge of the Christians. And they were many, many of them were put to death as a result. And so we believe that Mark is writing to a church who has firsthand experience of persecution and of real loss and the trials and the struggles and the cost of following Jesus and being known as a Christian. And so it's not really surprising that in Mark's gospel, almost a third of the whole gospel is taken up with the passion of Jesus. So from Palm Sunday through that Holy Week and the crucifixion story and the resurrection, that part of Jesus' life, whilst it might have only taken a week to live, it takes up a third of his gospel. His emphasis is on the suffering of Christ. And that is really pertinent to a church that is going through real suffering at the moment, at the time when they would be reading this account. It's sometimes been said that Mark's gospel is the story of Christ's passion with an extended prologue, an extended introduction. But really his whole point is get to the action, which is the death and resurrection of Jesus. And Mark's gospel is pacey. It's really fast moving. There's lots of word. The Greek word for immediately is repeated, I think, 42 times in his gospel. It's like immediately this and then this and immediately this. It's almost like reading a comic version, not in the sense that it's dumbed down, but that it's pacey. It's really fast. The action moves from one thing to another, to another, to another. And you don't get huge, long passages of teaching. Loads of stuff happens. It's a real action-packed gospel. So much so that it doesn't even have a birth narrative. He doesn't bother with any of the usual sort of introductory bits. There's no genealogy. There's no story of Jesus' birth and the circumstances around that or any childhood encounters with Jesus. He simply plunges straight in with the action. And he plunges in and starts with the appearance of John the Baptist, and I'll explain why that is significant in a moment or two. But to get us going, I thought it'd be great if we could listen to the first 20 verses. Now, 20 verses sounds a lot, but I've chosen a video for us to watch so that we can really sort of like delve into this and feel like we're part of the action. So this video will take us up to verse 20, and then Then Paul will read to us the passage that immediately follows, verses 21 to 28. So we're actually going to have a huge, quite a big chunk of that first chapter to enjoy together, but part of it will be as a video. So if you want to follow in your Bibles, it's Mark 1 from verse 1 through to eventually to verse 28 when we've watched the video and heard from Paul. So thanks, Gareth.
Beginning of the good news about Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet, I will send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. And so, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothing made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. And this was his message. After me comes the one more powerful than I, straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee, and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven. You are my Son, my love. With you, I am well pleased. At once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days, being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and angels attended him. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishing. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will send you out to fish for people. At once they left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat, preparing their nets. Without delay, he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him.
They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, Jesus went into the synagogue and began to teach. The people were amazed at his teaching, because he taught them as one who had authority, not as the teachers of the law. Just then, a man in the synagogue who was possessed by an evil spirit cried out, "What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." "Be quiet," said Jesus sternly. "Come out of him." The evil spirit shook the man violently and came out of him with a shriek. The people were all so amazed that they asked each other, "What is this? A new teaching and with authority. He even gives orders to evil spirits and they obey him." News about him spread quickly over the whole region of Galilee.
Thank you, Paul. So we are beginning this series in Mark's Gospel. And a lot has already happened, even in those first few verses that we've heard this morning. But what I'd like us to do this morning is to sort of get a grasp for the overview of the gospel itself. We'll have a quick look at the end at a particular few verses and see what the Holy Spirit might be saying to us through them. But I'd love for you to get this sort of overview of the gospel that we're going to be looking at over the coming weeks. So Mark's gospel has many good themes, but has two really big overriding themes. And the first is the authority of Jesus. And the second one is, who gets it? Who understands it? Who can answer this question that Jesus asks? Who do you say I am? For Mark, it's Jesus' authority and who he is, and then a reflection, a sort of examination of who it is who actually understands that, actually grasps that. And you see this played out through his gospel. So here's the shape, like a mountain range. Here's the shape of Mark's gospel. In the first eight chapters, we get his early ministry, mainly based in Galilee, and he is shown increasingly as one with authority. We've already seen some of this, even in this first chapter, but we will get to see in these first eight chapters of Mark's gospel, we'll see that he is one who has authority over demons, over sickness, over the Sabbath, over death, over nature itself. He has authority to teach as no other does. He has authority to forgive sins, which it is understood only God can. And he has authority to call people, to call the disciples, as we've just seen in this first chapter. He is described and depicted as a man of authority, and not just human authority, but something far beyond what people expected. So if the first section, the first half almost of his gospel, is about showing Jesus to be the one with authority, then you get the high point of this gospel, of these questions of who Jesus is and who recognizes that to be true. You get the high point in chapters 8 and 9, where Jesus actually asks this question of his disciples, "Who do you say I am?" And that's when Peter makes this confession. He has a glimmer of understanding and says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And then it doesn't stop there. Jesus affirms and agrees with Peter, but then goes on to say, but the Son of Man, the Messiah, must suffer and die. And so he takes their understanding and begins to reshape it. Yes, he's one with authority, but that authority points to him being the Messiah, the one they've waited for. He is it, but he needs to help them reframe, reshape what it is they understand that Messiah to be all about. And so in this high point, literally on the top of a mountain, they also have the transfiguration, and Jesus is revealed in his glory. The "who do you say I am" becomes really obvious when he's there in glory during the transfiguration. So we get that little bit in the middle, with that sort of revelation and understanding, the aha moment for some of the disciples. But that's sort of short-lived, because like us, they get their vision clouded once again. And then we have the passion of Christ. We have Jesus depicted as, and in his own words, being a ransom for many. And that forms the last part of his gospel. But the gospel as a whole shows us the answer to these questions, that Mark is describing who Jesus is and helping us to understand that, and showing who it is that grasps the identity, that what Jesus is all about. And then it culminates in his death and resurrection, which is why he came. Now, there's lots of pointers throughout the gospel that show that this is one of his main reasons for writing. This is the big theme of his gospel, the authority of Jesus and who it is who understands it. So even right at the start, that very opening verse of the gospel, Mark himself sets it out. It's clear as a bell. The beginning of the gospel about Jesus Christ. Even if we stop there, he's already made a statement, because Christ, remember, is not Jesus's surname. Christ is the Greek way of saying the Messiah, which is the Hebrew term, the one, the anointed one, the one they've been waiting for. So even putting those two names together, Jesus and Messiah, Jesus and Christ, Mark is making a statement. The gospel about Jesus, the anointed one, the one we've been waiting for, the Son of God. So Mark would make a rubbish whodunit writer, wouldn't he? Because he's already told us the answer right at the start. He's absolutely set out his stall. He said, this is an account I am writing, and this is the person it's all about. And do you know who he is? He is the Christ. He is the Son of God. And so Mark is really upfront. He's writing this because this is who he knows Jesus to be, and this is the conclusion he wants his readers to come to too. So there's the first clue. Hardly a clue, it's an outright statement. But we have God the Father himself at Jesus' baptism confirming this. You are my son, whom I love. We have the demon that in the account that Paul just read, who shouts out, I know who you are, the Holy One of God. We have Peter's confession, you are the Christ, coming in chapter 8. And again, in the Transfiguration, God the Father once again confirms that this is my son, whom I love. And this time it comes with the command, listen to him. We have the beggars and those who are right on the outside of society, those who are in desperate need. They seem to be ones who get it. Bartimaeus, the blind beggar, shouts out to Jesus as he's passing by, Son of David, have mercy on me. And the Son of David language is the same language of Messiah. So in that sense, even those who are desperate in need and who have no other hope, they perhaps, because of their need, they are ones who grasp who Jesus is, whilst others are still sort of wondering and pondering and arguing about it, or not getting it at all. Those who are most desperate seem to have a real insight into who Jesus is. And then on the cross, as Jesus is dying, the centurion, a Gentile, not even one of God's people, passes by and makes this prophetic statement, or a statement of extraordinary insight. And we don't know how far that goes. We know nothing more about this individual, this centurion who makes this statement, but it's profound and prophetic that it is made at that moment when he declares, surely this man was the Son of God. So right from beginning to end, we hear different voices from different realms and different sort of statuses and different parts of society confirming and affirming who Jesus is, that he is the Son of God. He is the Christ, the Messiah, the Holy One, the one they've been waiting for. And as I say, very often it's the ones who are in most need, who are the poor, who are the outcast, who are crippled, who are beggars. It's them who also see Jesus for whom he is, whilst everybody else is sort of not quite sure. The one I want us to just draw attention to for a few minutes this morning is this one that we heard read this morning. Because these words of proclamation of who Jesus is are not on the lips of beggars. They're not on the lips of Jesus' disciples. They do not come from God himself, God the Father. I know who you are, the Holy One of God. Those words are spoken from the demonic, from somebody who is in opposition to God's kingdom. They get it too. They guess who Jesus is before any humans do. Now, the times there are changing, right? When Mark is writing his gospel and he's writing about Jesus coming, the times have changed. The Old Testament ends with sort of everybody holding their breath and waiting. Even at the end of the Old Testament, in Malachi, we read, "See, I will send you a prophet, Elijah, before the great and dreadful day of the Lord comes. He will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers." And that was, we saw in Advent, that was a prophecy speaking about, and we believe fulfilled in, the birth of John and the ministry of John. And so the Old Testament closes, leaving everybody's breath being held, waiting for the Messiah to come, but waiting for this Elijah-style forerunner to also appear that would proclaim and herald in the time of this Messiah, the one they're waiting for. So Mark, perhaps as he's sitting down to write and deciding, well, how shall I begin? There's so much material to work with. What am I trying to say? And where do I start? It's as if he takes up that bated breath that we're left with at the end of the Old Testament and plunges straight in with his gospel as John bursts onto the scene, this Elijah-style forerunner to proclaim that the Messiah is on his way. And so, as the Old Testament ends holding its breath, the gospel starts and announces that the thing that they've been waiting for has just happened. Jesus' first words that we heard in that video were these: "The time has come. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news." What brilliant words to have Jesus say as a first opening statement, given where the Old Testament left everybody. Mark comes in and introduces Jesus, shows us who he is, and his words are, "You've been waiting. The time has come." And so in this very first sort of miracle and little encounter that Jesus has, that Mark puts right at the start of the gospel, I kind of think, and this isn't just my own thinking, this is thinking from a friend of mine, a colleague at the college, Helen Painter. She's been thinking about this as well. And this first encounter that Jesus has, this first miraculous event that is recorded by Mark, highlights the fact that this new dawn has broken, that the powers of darkness cannot coexist with Jesus. The kingdom of darkness, which has held the earth in its clutches since sin first entered the human story, this kingdom of darkness is threatened by this move of God. And Jesus' presence pierces the spiritual darkness. Now, humanity is largely blind and deaf at this stage to the fact that Jesus is who he is. But the invasion of heaven's kingdom into the kingdom of darkness, the realm of history, well, that is keenly felt in the spiritual world. And it's resisted by the occupying forces, as it were. It's resisted, but to borrow a term from Star Trek, resistance is futile. The demonic voices in Mark's gospel know from the outset who Jesus is, and they sense what this means for them. "Have you come to destroy us?" says the voice in the synagogue. In the synagogue, not out in the tombs or in some lonely, weird place. In the synagogue, in the heart of the place that was the center of the town of Capernaum, the heartbeat of the worshiping community, in that place. The demonic is present. The darkness is still there. And Jesus comes into the synagogue and is confronted, opposed. "I know who you are, the Holy One of God. Have you come to destroy us?" You bet he's come to destroy you. But that's not quite where we get to at that point in the story. But the demonic realm, the demons, the voices of the demonic in Mark's gospel recognize who Jesus is right from the outset. But in the midst of all this, I want us to notice something else about how Mark portrays Jesus. Yes, the spiritual battle has begun. The human aspect of that battle will gain momentum in time, right up to the cross. But Jesus is portrayed as one with authority. And as we've seen, for those who can actually see it, he is portrayed as the very Son of God. But even as Jesus' popularity is rising amongst the ordinary people, The speaking invitations are coming thick and fast, and his audiences are growing. The crowds are enthralled by his teaching, and they're wowed by his miracle working, and they're entertained perhaps by his ability to parry arguments with the authorities. Even then, Jesus remains humble and submits to God's leading at every stage. He's first and foremost the servant of the living God. Now, he will go on to embody Isaiah's prophetic poem of the suffering servant in due course. But here at the start of the gospel, you know, his star is rising, his fame is growing, yet he doesn't seek fame. In fact, it seems he flees from it, telling people to keep quiet after he's healed them, telling people and telling the demonic to be quiet about who he is, moving from one town just as his reputation is reaching an all-time high. He seeks only to do the will of the one who sent him. In verse 35 of this first chapter, we read, "Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Simon and his companions went to look for him. And when they found him, they exclaimed, 'Everyone is looking for you.' Jesus replied, 'Let us go somewhere else, to the nearby villages, so I can preach there also. That is why I've come.' And so he traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out demons." Now, we may not crave fame on this scale, but notice Jesus' recipe for keeping his feet on the ground. And let's face it, these feet had every right to be floating somewhere high above our heads and walking the streets of heaven. But before all else, Jesus sought God's will for his life. He carved out time before anything else, in terms of priority, above everything else, to get alone with God and to attune his thinking to God's perspective, to allow his heart to beat in time with the Father's heart. And in doing so, he gained clarity about his purpose in life and his next steps, practically speaking, his priorities, his decisions. He proved himself to be a true servant of God, not a slave to popular opinion. Now, we may not crave fame or popularity on the same scale that was offered to Jesus, but whose good opinion do we genuinely seek? Are we living to please God first and foremost before anyone else, knowing that his best for us will also be a blessing to others in our lives? Are we seeking his will first and foremost? Are we performing for an audience of one, God alone? Let's examine our hearts, friends. The choices we make, the lifestyle we are building for ourselves, the way we present ourselves to the world, the purpose of our very lives, is it to please Father God, or is it to gain approval from others, however precious those others might be to us? I know in my life, some years ago, whilst I was ministering and working for the kingdom and, you know, reaching out and trying to build something for God, I actually became aware that the very people that God had put into my life around me, good Christian folk, I would have said spiritual giants, those who I really looked up to, who were alongside me working for the kingdom, I came to realize, and I believe God showed me, that actually I was enthralled to them in the sense that I was making decisions with them in mind first and foremost. Would they approve? Would these spiritual giants who I respected and loved dearly, would they think what I was doing was right? And I realized that my focus had shifted from asking God what to do to imagining what these other people would say. And as I say, these were godly people, good people. But I knew in my heart when God showed me that actually I was beginning to live according to their will, or what I thought might be their will. I was living to please them and assuming that that was enough because, you know, they were close with God. So if I pleased them, surely I'd be pleasing God. When in fact, what I was shown was that I had to just put that aside, run the risk of offending or disappointing or not being entirely in tune with, run the risk of that, because I had to do what God would call me to do. And in fact, you know, God's will and what my friends hoped for were in tune with one another. That was not a problem at all. But I knew in my heart I was beginning to live and make decisions and choices according to what I thought these people would think of me rather than what God would. And I needed to confess that and readjust, refocus my life again on pleasing God before anyone else. May we learn from Jesus' example, and empowered by the Holy Spirit, my prayer is that we would live with clarity about who this is all for. So even if you realize that deep down you are, in fact, living to please others or simply to please yourself, then my friends, please hear Jesus' words and be challenged and be encouraged. The kingdom of God is near. Repent, means turn around, change direction, and believe the good news. Because the good news is that we can find fullness of life and true meaning when we live for something greater than ourselves. And in surrendering to the one who knows us and loves us, we'll gain freedom from slavery to popular opinion. Whether that's likes on Facebook, followers on Twitter, admiration of colleagues, devotion of your friends, approval by your boss, whoever it might be. What do you benefit, Jesus said, if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? So let's take this challenge and repent and turn away from chasing after such things and return to a place of devotion to God alone, perhaps kneeling before him, declaring him alone as Lord of our lives. Maybe we need to confess our natural desire to be thought well of by other people or to seek the favor of others. Let's be brave enough to leave all that up to God and recommit ourselves to living first and foremost for his purposes. I don't know what that's going to look like for you, but I would encourage you to take a hard look at your motivation of who you're living for. Are you a servant of God before all else? Or are you in some way a slave to someone else's opinion of you? With all that power and authority that Jesus wielded, he remained a servant of God, committed to the Father's will for his life, not a slave to popular opinion. May we follow his example and discover the freedom that brings. Shall we pray together? Father God, thank you that by sending Jesus into the world, you pierced that darkness. You broke in to the fortress that had been built around the world by the incursion of sin and darkness. You broke in definitively and made a way for us to be redeemed and rescued and set free. Lord, we know that naturally speaking, other people's opinion of us really matters. It hurts when we are criticized. It saddens us when friends disapprove or we don't see eye to eye with one another. And we long for harmony and for living well alongside each other. And whilst we seek that and we seek to be at peace with one another in your strength, we don't ever want that to become our main goal if it means that we are ruled and governed by other people's opinions of us. Lord God, forgive us if we've taken our eyes off you, if somehow you have slipped out of first place in our life, if we have begun to make choices and living our lives and ordering our days around ourselves or around other people's opinions. Forgive us. Help us to take our foot off the pedal, to redirect the trajectory of our life and to refocus on you. May we live, help us to do this by your Spirit. May we live as followers of Jesus, those who will copy and emulate, imitate our Master and live 100% devoted to you, knowing that in that, in being devoted and passionate about you, other things fall into place. we remember those words of Jesus, to seek first your kingdom and your righteousness, and all other things will be added. May we put you first in all things. And where we are blind to the fact that you're not first in our lives in some area, Holy Spirit, we ask for revelation. We ask for you to shine your light so that we may put it right. We may confess and return to having you, Lord, at the center of our vision, the center of our life, the purpose that gives us meaning, the one we live for. Set us free in the power of the Spirit to live this way for you. Amen. We're going to finish up with a song that helps us to sort of put that into words and music. So we're going to be using the song Build My Life, which gives us a chance to continue to pray and dedicate ourselves to God this morning. Thanks, Gareth.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none.
And so may God help us each this day to walk in the light of his Spirit as we seek to live for his glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.